10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
Today on Studio One, haunted houses put together this time of year can have all sorts of gadgets. In order to play it safe, one fire department wants to become part of the planning. Also, a group of meteorologists in training reaches out to the next generation. We'll show you what some Girl Scouts learned while earning a weather badge. And there is something special about that new car smell. We'll spend a day in the life of someone who can almost bring your car back to that perfect state.
Celebrating 20 years from the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks, this is Studio One.
Hello everyone and welcome to Studio One. I'm Monty Cashel.
And I'm Kelly Corbo. Now kids are known for having a ton of energy.
Oh yeah.
And sometimes that energy may be misplaced, like in a classroom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or maybe sitting in church or something like that.
Or church, yeah, mm-hmm. Something like that. And they actually might have a disorder called ADHD. It's Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder.
Mm-hmm. Heard of it?
Mm-hmm, exactly. Mm-hmm. But it also affects adults. But sometimes they just don't have the same symptoms. Sometimes with adults, they can't finish like a task, or they don't really have a good concept of time management kind of thing. Time just flies by, literally.
Kind of like the half-finished basement I haven't finished for my wife yet kind of thing.
Yeah, you should stay tuned for the next right. For the upcoming interview. We actually have a gentleman who is a teacher, and he has ADHD, so he will give us some tips on how he deals with his ADHD problem throughout the days.
All right, interesting. Also coming up on the show, this time of year, several groups set up haunted houses. We'll show you how firefighters in one city are taking part in the planning process.
Also, you may have a coworker that you just don't understand. This may happen when they are from different generation. We'll talk to a woman who can clear up the misunderstandings that can happen with different generations in the workplace.
But first, here's today's news with Ken Seiden.
Thanks, Monty and Kelly. Officials in Southern California have announced that one of the state's wildfires was started by a child. The fire started last week and burned more than 38,000 acres. The boy, whose name and age are not being disclosed, has been released to the custody of his parents. Police say he admitted to them that he accidentally started the fire when he was playing with matches. The case has been given to the district attorney, who will make a decision on whether any charges will be filed or not. The fire was one of 15 fires that destroyed more than 2,100 homes and killed 14 people. The famous Dog the Bounty Hunter may now be in trouble himself. An audio tape captured Dwayne the Dog Chapman using racial slurs to describe his son's African-American girlfriend. The tape was released on the National Enquirer website. Chapman released a statement apologizing, but A&E still announced it is suspending his show. Energy drinks have been connected to some health problems, and doctors say some drinks may be worse than others. A few energy drinks have been linked to heart, blood pressure, and hydration issues. Some people are concerned that if young children drink them, they'll have long-term health problems. There are ingredients in some of the drinks that have been connected to serious short-term health problems.
The ephedra-type products like pseudoephedrine and those and other ephedrine sort of things that are in there actually are linked to deaths in the country. And you know, that's why the ephedra products, some of them have been actually even taken off of the market.
Doctors say that an occasional energy drink should not cause any problems, but they stress that moderation is important. People rent cars for many reasons. A study conducted by the University of Alabama found that not all of those reasons are legal. The study shows that people who use crack cocaine are renting their cars to dealers in exchange for drugs. The cars provide the dealers with a different vehicle to transport drugs and make them harder to catch. Further studies on what the researchers call rock rentals are planned. Researchers say the most important part of future studies is how to find out how rock rentals affect the work of police. Ghouls, ghosts, and the occasional odd costume are things associated with Halloween. The Grand Forks Fire Department in North Dakota is making sure that a safe holiday can also be expected.
Every October, the Delta Tau Delta fraternity sponsors an event that gives their community a real scream. Although creating a place this haunting can be fun, it is also a lot of hard work to make it safe. The haunted house first had to pass an inspection done by the fire department before opening its doors. People involved with the project have put a lot of work into the house.
Getting the tarps up, flame retardant tarps, no less, and just taping everything up, getting all the rooms situated. It goes in a lot of planning, but it's well worth it.
Each year, the Grand Forks Fire Department is available to help groups that create haunted houses to ensure that they are safe.
And probably the most important thing, whether it's public or private, is that they have a home escape plan. Okay, that's where, how they're going to get out of the building, and that should be built into your haunted house. If something should happen, how are we going to get out?
Some regulations that groups hosting haunted houses must follow are using flame-retardant materials, having working fire extinguishers, and providing tour guides.
If we get some of the younger children, they may get frightened and scared, and we need somebody at a light switch to be able to get those lights on to help those children.
This event is fun not only for the guests, but also for the group that runs it.
It's a lot of work, but I mean, you get to spend time with, you know, all the guys in the house, so that's a lot of fun.
The fire department says that all of the work that goes into a project like a haunted house is necessary.
Our number one goal is, you know, life safety of these children and the people that are living in the house on campus.
At the end of the evening, the tours end safely, but not without one last scare. With photographer Urien Johansson, I'm Ashley Portra, reporting for Studio One News.
The proceeds from the haunted house are donated to the charity in the Grand Forks community each year. And that's the news for now. Monty and Kelly.
Thanks, Ken. Well, if you like getting scared, that looked like fun.
That looks so scary. Those girls were very brave for going through that.
They were screaming.
I would be too. All right, let's go to Stephen Doyle to get some weather news. Stephen?
Well, thanks, Monty and Kelly. Well, the weather news for up in Grand Forks, we've been enjoying temperatures above average, but we finally cooled down to where we should be for this time of year. In Grand Forks, we should be seeing an average high of 43 degrees. 45 is your average high in Bismarck, 3 degrees Celsius north of the border in Winnipeg. Around the rest of the nation, 55 is your average high in Chicago as well as Salt Lake City, 71 down in Dallas, and 75 in Los Angeles. Well, end of October, beginning of November, it's for those of you who are living in the upper Midwest, especially back in the year 1991, you probably remember what we're going to talk about. We're going to give you a little history lesson of the Halloween blizzard. The way this whole setup, or the whole situation set up, we had a hurricane-like storm. It wasn't an official hurricane, but we had a hurricane-like storm in the Atlantic. And it basically stalled everything from progressing over the lower 48. So the high pressure system stalled here over New England, and that caused this low pressure system to stall, even backtrack slightly. Areas shaded in green saw continuous rain. It was from October 31st through November 3rd of 1991. And behind the warm front, we had all sorts of snow in Minnesota into southern Ontario. A lot of snow was dumped. We broke the single storm snowfall record for Duluth, Minnesota. That's right up here. 37 inches of snow fell in that three-day span of time from that one single storm system. And you can see the effects of the snow all the way through central Minnesota, down towards Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and into southwestern Wisconsin and southeastern Minnesota, stretch even further south from there. But as far as precipitation goes around the country, you probably won't have to worry about snow just yet, but you will have to keep an eye out for above average precipitation through upper Minnesota, down through the Great Lakes region, into southern Ontario. Much of the country, especially over here in California and Nevada, stretching all the way across through the central portion of the country, down through the southeast, can expect to see less precipitation than average through November 12th. As far as temperatures, the southeast can expect to see cooler than average conditions through that same time period up through into the central plains. And west part of the country, from the central Rockies up through Montana, southwest Canada, all the way over to the Pacific coast, can expect to be warmer than average through that time as well. Well, I mentioned the snowfall record for the single storm snowfall total. There's another record broken by that Halloween blizzard. We're going to ask you to pick it out. We'll be back later on with the answer. And Monty and Kelly, this storm definitely affected a lot of people. Over 60 counties in Minnesota and Iowa were declared disaster areas, and over 100,000 people lost power due to the storm, in some cases as long as a week.
Jeez, wow, that's one strong storm. Thanks, Stephen.
Yeah. Well, you don't like having to go through those too often, so it's nice.
Especially on Halloween, mess up your whole costume
setup.
That's
right. You got to trudge through the snow just to get candy.
Oh, geez. Well worth it, though.
That's right. Let's go to sports news now, and Nick Johnson.
Thank you, Monty and Kelly. In Seattle, it's out with Ray Allen, in with Kevin Durant as the city's basketball star. This move is particularly interesting considering Durant is a rookie getting his first NBA action on Wednesday. And he would get the start visiting the Nuggets. Down 8 in the first quarter here, he drives against 3 defenders and gets the lay-in for his first NBA points. Congratulations, young fella. The Sonics would lead for a good portion of this game until the second half when Carmelo Anthony starts heating up. Whew, somebody fanned me. Fourth quarter now, Eduardo Nájera knocks the ball away. It gets up to Allen Iverson, over to Carmelo for the slam game blouses. Nuggets go on to roll behind Anthony's 32 points, winning this one 120-103. How about the Bulls visiting the Nets? Down 12 in the second quarter here, Jason Kidd makes the steal. Nowhere to go with it except to Richard Jefferson for the throwdown. He had 29 to lead the Nets, but the Chicago Bulls do come back. Andres Nocioni buries the three here when they were down 3 to tie up the game and to send it into overtime. He's not quite MJ yet, but he's getting there. How about in overtime in the extra session? Richard Jefferson with a three of his own. That would lead the Nets to a 112-103 win in overtime. The National Hockey League has received criticism for its lack of television deals, but numbers have shown that the league is prospering despite low TV ratings. More people are finding their NHL information and highlights online. The online availability has made up for a shortage of hockey on television. While other leagues are protective of their broadcast rights, the NHL can be found all around the web.
One thing I did notice last year was how when I'd sign on to YouTube or whatever, I'd see NHL highlights, and I thought that was kind of interesting. I didn't see like any NBA or NFL.
The online success has led to more people going to games. The NHL set attendance records the previous two seasons. Last season, an average game filled more than 90% of seats in arenas. It's now time for the Studio One sports trivia question. Who was the only team in college basketball history to beat 3 number one seeds in an NCAA tournament? That's only happened one time, and you've only got one answer that's correct there. And we'll have that later on in the show. That's the sports. Monty and Kelly.
Thanks, Nick. In a new movie, the life of crime is very appealing for one man. Another man finds it his passion to stop a major New York drug lord. Later, we'll take a look at a film that revolves around two opposite worlds.
Also, different generations work in very different ways. We'll talk to someone who teaches business people how to function better by understanding each other.
Come on. My tuition. It is very cute, very cuddly. I can give you 2 for 1. 2 for 1.
Bad idea.
How about 3 for 1?
That's a really bad business idea.
North Dakota has more than 109,000 proud alumni. Whether it's connecting you with classmates or planning your estate, we can do more than ever for you and your alma mater. UND Alumni Association and the UND Foundation. We're helping you help UND.
Coming home from a busy day at work, sitting at your favorite coffee shop, reading with your kids, and fulfilling your dreams. At the University of North Dakota, you can fit your education into your life. UND Continuing Education offers flexible options including online courses, degree programs, and professional certifications. Never stop learning with UND Continuing Education.
You're watching Studio One. Honored by the Northwest Broadcast News Association for excellence in cable television.
Very Veterans, baby boomers, and Generation X are all terms that categorize a generation of people. We've all had experiences where we scratch our heads trying to figure out why someone from a different generation acts the way they do. This can lead to difficult relationships in the workplace. Gretchen Schatz talks to businesses about the ways generations can begin to understand each other better. Thanks for coming on the show today.
Welcome.
Well, first of all, why is it important to study generations?
Several reasons. First, we learn about ourselves, gain insight of ourselves. We also learn how to communicate better in the workplace, in our workplace setting. We learn to be better managers and supervisors and build more productive teams. It's also essential for recruitment and retention.
Okay, and there's a lot of cost involved with recruitment and, right. and when you have to hire somebody as well, correct?
Yes, and if you're not in a position to be recruiting the people that you want and retain the people that you want, you're going to be expending a lot of money each time with your turnover. Okay. As if you learn more about generations, you can learn about how to retain the people that you want and recruit the people that you want.
Okay. What generations are currently working together?
Right now, this is historically significant because we have four generations working in the workplace. We have the veterans who are 65 years of age and older, and so many of them are starting to retire, but we still see them on a part-time basis or volunteer basis. We also have the baby boomers who are 47 years of age to 64, and they make up 76% of the population. The first baby boomers are just starting to collect Social Security, so many of them are getting closer to retirement age as well. And there will be a significant reduction in force when they start to retire, and we need to start doing some succession planning when we consider that. There's Generation X. They are 28 years of age to age 46. And there's only 40 million of those folks, so about half the population when you consider the baby boomers. And then we've got Generation Y, who are 27 years of age and younger, and there's 72 million of them. And they will make up our primary workforce for the next 10 years.
Okay. And you mentioned the different age that categorizes some of these. What about some of the characteristics of these different groups?
Well, if you look at baby boomers, they were many of them were brought up during the Great Depression, and so they tend to be more frugal. They're very dependable, reliable employees. They don't outwardly complain. They don't talk about their feelings or their problems. If they have a concern, they'll bring it to you and discuss it face to face. They're also not very comfortable with public recognition. The baby boomers grew up during anti-authority times. They grew up under controlling veterans as parents, so they have a little bit different way of doing work. They also are uncomfortable with conflict. They want to get all players to the table at the same time and discuss the issue openly. Because they're uncomfortable with conflict, sometimes they will procrastinate and not deal with an issue right away, but hope that it'll just go away. Baby boomers are, the term workaholic was coined for the baby boomers because they, their work is what makes them. And public recognition they are comfortable with. Generation X grew up in a time when birth control was the leading health concern. And most often both of their parents worked outside of the home. So many of them were independent. The term latchkey was coined for this generation. They more technology was introduced during this time. The first microwave, cell phone, bag phone, computer in the home. And they got pretty comfortable with working independently, multitasking, and comfortable with technology. To them, change is no big deal. But what they also grew up with is not having their parents at home, and so they tend to have a little bit different idea about work. Work comes second, family comes first.
And what about Y? They're the last ones.
Y, they had very involved parents. They were very, they have helicopter parents who are concerned about everything they do and keep them highly involved in many activities. They are not as likely to seek perfection. They will often be all right with good enough. They tend, if you're Generation Y and having a good time at work and laughing at work, you're going to be losing them. They are looking for a strong leader. They are looking for someone who is concerned with them. They want a mentor.
Well, that's quite a mixture. And when you talk to businesses after you give your session, What is the feedback you get from them? What is the thing they notice the most?
What they're very much interested in is they learn more about themselves. They learn more about their own family members, and they learn more about their colleagues, their team. And sometimes it's that big aha moment, like, oh, that's why that person does that. Oftentimes that frustrates me, but now I understand why they do that. I can work with that.
Sure. And what about the people who don't exactly fit in the categories?
We've got a term that we call, some of them would be cuspers, and those would be the individuals that fall between two generations, or their older generation X, younger baby boomers. And what's special about these folks is they understand more than one generation. They understand both generations that they fall between. And so they have characteristics of both, but they also have a little bit of inner turmoil too, because say if they're a cusper between Generation X and Baby Boomer, they will put in a lot of hours and they'll work very hard for their job, but then they want that time off when it's due to them.
Sure. Well, what is the underlying message with all of this study of generations that you try and get out to people?
We tend to tell the managers and supervisors and folks that take these courses that we offer on managing generations in the workplace that it's essential to adapt. It's essential to be open-minded about the differences in the different generations. And what's most important, you can't really expect 72 million generation Y to hit the workforce and expect to adapt to just meet your individual needs. You need to adapt to meet their needs.
Sure. So it's the leaders that have to change because the workforce is not going to.
Exactly.
Okay. Well, thanks so much for coming on the show today, Gretchen. Very interesting stuff.
Thank you.
Coming up, some athletes resort to illegal drugs to get bigger and stronger. We'll tell you what's being done to try to cut down on the use of those substances. Also, cars come in all shapes, sizes, and colors. Sometimes it can be hard to tell what color. We'll spend a day in the life of someone who helps clean away the dirt and helps show off a shine.
Studio One closed captioning is underwritten in part by Options, your disability information source.
Earn your engineering degree from the University of North Dakota while you continue to work. Through online lectures and brief on-campus lab work, you can earn your bachelor's degree in chemical, civil, electrical, or mechanical engineering.
We have a very good program here, and I'm very pleased and excited to be part of it.
All online engineering degrees are ABET accredited. Contact UND today to engineer your career for tomorrow.
UND's Center for Innovation, serving the entrepreneur community with two tech incubators, providing creative space for creative people, access to capital and university talent, scientific wet lab, state-of-the-art meeting space, startup and technical assistance services, recognition and networking. UND's Center for Innovation, the entrepreneur place.
Working with the Office of Workforce Development is great because year after year they get to the point where they know us, they know our challenges, they know our opportunities. Strategic planning has been very important for us at the mill. It keeps us focused, it keeps us moving forward in the direction that we need to go.
Companies grow through strategic planning and successful workforce training. Discover the advantages through the Office of Workforce Development at the University of North Dakota.
There's a place where American Indian culture is celebrated, where helping others is a priority and encouragement is abundant. At American Indian Student Services, our goal is retention and graduation of American Indian students. The American Indian Center is a home away from home, where students can find state-of-the-art technology and a friendly face willing to help. Contact American Indian Student Services at 1-800-CALL-UND.
Police corruption and the mafia often play major parts in gangster movies. The movie American Gangster is based on a true story that occurred during the 1970s. Denzel Washington plays a black entrepreneur, Frank Lucas. Frank was an apprentice to a drug lord in New York until his boss dies. Then he creates his own business. Lucas outplays all of the leading crime leaders and becomes one of the Cedar City's mainline corruptors. Russell Crowe plays a cop who learns about the shift of control in the drug world and is after Lucas. Lucas has a strong family life and the officer's personal life is out of control. Directors used these two opposites to bring the two characters together. Denzel Washington met with the actual Frank Lucas to help him better prepare for the role.
What interested me in the story was not to glorify a drug dealer, and I told Frank that when I met him. I found it fascinating that he only did 15 years in prison when he was caught.
The movie was filmed in New York and Thailand. These cities are where Lucas made his connections to become a leader in the New York Mafia. American Gangster opens in theaters November 2nd. Now it's time to look at the events happening in your area. Allow you to enter in covered in mud, and when you leave, you're full of sparkle. For two men, that sparkle is what they strive to give. Today, we spend a day in the life of a car wash attendant.
A place full of twinkling signs, brightly colored foam, and a special day for each of us may seem like a treasure. For two men, this trove of treasures is one they get to open every day. The car wash is a pot of gold for David and Eric.
Just so rewarding to see something come in and look so bad, and then at the end you know that your hard work went into it and it's just perfect.
They don't let this treasure tarnish. With plenty of hard work, they add the perfect polish to every car. But boys will be boys, no matter how rare the gem.
And I got blasted by my coworker Eric today, so.
Just perfect, too, just a big old spot on his legs.
Any extra money earned is just a reflection on their effort.
Regular customers, they expect, you know, that we do a good job, they know we do a good job, and they will occasionally give you a little tip here and there.
Inside this trunk of trinkets, the sounds.
Engine off and put off the brake. Okay. Thank you.
And the sights are as exciting as the people within it. And after all the cars are clean, David and Eric know that they have
the greatest job in the world.
And with that, the treasure chest closes. Until tomorrow. Reporting for Studio One, I'm Haley Venzel.
David says they've only turned one car away. It was a Hummer and it was just too big to fit inside. Coming up, a group with weather on their mind tries to make science appealing to a young audience. That story plus new sports and weather in the next half hour of Studio One.
Get a degree from the University of North Dakota without leaving the Bismarck area. The UND Bismarck Center offers quality and convenient master's degree programs and courses that fit your lifestyle.
I was able to obtain a quality degree from the University of North Dakota and at the same time have the flexibility to continue my career here in the Bismarck area.
Call for a complete list of degrees in cooperation with and located on the Bismarck State College campus.
The School of Engineering and Mines at UND has a long history of preparing students for successful careers. Through small classes and faculty involvement, students have unique opportunities to gain hands-on experience. Here, students launch a weather balloon to test a remote imaging device destined for Earth orbit. Students can also become involved in wind energy and fuel cell projects, design, build, and race a Formula One car, or even develop a camera that will generate agricultural images from the International Space Station. Find out for yourself how you can get involved at UND School of Engineering and Mines.
Become a leader in healthcare with a graduate degree from the University of North Dakota. The Graduate School at UND offers degree programs and advanced practice certificate programs in the allied health professions and nursing. Our faculty give you the individual attention you need to help you attain your career goals. Distance programs for practicing professionals allow you to pursue graduate studies without interrupting your career. Contact the UND Graduate School today.
From the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks, this is Studio One.
Welcome back to Studio One.
Thanks for joining us today. Well, there are many laws in place, and for good reason. Mm-hmm. You know, there's always a reason to have laws. And neighborhood watches have popped up all over in communities.
Oh, yeah. You always see the sign, we're watching
you. That's right. Yep. Mm-hmm. People looking out for each other. And also, though, people can be watching each other, not just looking out for each other.
Oh, yeah, to see if they're breaking the city laws.
Right, because there's things like, you know, if there's a drought happening, you're not supposed to water your lawn, someone's watering their lawn, some people might tell on you.
No, no, definitely.
And we wanted to find out if people were comfortable with snitching on their neighbors. So we asked them that question. Their answers are coming up in a little bit. Also, in the next 30 minutes on Studio One, technology is taking the pencil and paper tests out of many classrooms. See how one university is allowing students to click in with the right answers.
Also, a pastime for a group of people have brought them back from their childhood. Whether it was playing with models or doing research, this group has a blast. Later, we'll take you to an event that left its spectators in awe.
And almost everyone has had trouble keeping focus and getting something accomplished. We will talk with a man who educates others about a disorder that deals with paying attention. But first, here's today's news with Ken Seiden.
Thanks, Monty and Kelly. New York City police officers are investigating a hate crime on the Columbia University campus. This is the second hate crime to take place at the Ivy League college in the past month. A Jewish professor found a swastika on her office door on Wednesday. Last month, an African-American professor found a noose hanging outside her office. The NYPD's hate crime department is investigating the crimes. However, no arrests have been made. NASA officials are under questioning on Capitol Hill after failing to release findings from a safety survey. In the study, pilots were questioned on the issues of airline safety.
What we are saying is, get this done and get it out to the public.
NASA discovered that more close calls and problems were occurring on the runway than they previously believed. The agency decided to withhold the information found in the survey. Officials say they did not mean to dismiss the findings, but also did not want to upset travelers. NASA plans to release the study findings by the end of the year. It is being called a superbug. A new government report says 90,000 Americans were affected with the drug-resistant staph infection called MRSA in 2005. Most staph cases have been mild skin infections. The bacteria may turn deadly when it enters the bloodstream. This type of bacteria is most commonly seen in athletic locker rooms and school gyms. The news of the outbreak is making many school officials plan ahead in case of an outbreak in their schools.
Once you get to an outbreak, it becomes a public health issue, and we would take a lot of our direction from the city and county health department and those types of things to find out, you know, what do we need to do, what type of cleaner should we be using.
This bacteria was recently found in schools in many states, including Virginia, New York, Michigan, and Ohio. Sometimes it can take a while for people to receive their mail. For one woman in Japan, it took 64 years. Shizu Nagano received a postcard from a former coworker who was killed in World War II in 1945. The postcard was collected by an American soldier after the U.S. had defeated Japanese soldiers at Burma. After the soldier died, his son kept the letter, eventually giving it to a Japanese exchange student in Hawaii. The student then spent 2 years searching for Nagano so she could receive the postcard. Several college campuses are bringing a new technology into their classrooms. It is up to the teacher whether or not they want to use it.
The latest trend in technology for instructors at the University of North Dakota goes to class with students every day in their backpacks. A live response system is being used in lectures to test students' opinions, take quizzes and tests, and check attendance. They call it a clicker. Buying textbooks for a course can be expensive for students. Adding a clicker to your budget will cost up to $50. Students have enjoyed the new addition to the classroom.
I think for quizzes and stuff, it helps a lot because as you're taking the quizzes, he can explain the answers to you.
The clicker lets instructors know who has been keeping up on their reading. Anatomy assistant professor John Jackson uses his clickers as a teacher's assistant.
We take our tests using these clickers in my class. They know their test scores before I know their test scores.
Some say one disadvantage of the clicker is that it is run by batteries.
The batteries usually last an entire semester, so unless you leave it on or are trying to open your garage door with it.
If clickers break, students can lose their participation points for that day.
Sometimes they don't work like you think that they should.
Questions are in multiple choice form, usually having at least two options to choose from.
In the lower extremity, the most medial vein, that's what this question asks.
After all the students have answered, the results are shown on a projection screen within the next 30 seconds.
It definitely doesn't stress me out to see the answers. Actually, I think it's pretty much the opposite. I think it really helps you out.
Instructors can either plan their questions before class or think of them on the spot. They say the clicker is one way to let them know who is in class and who knows the information. For class participation, an A is just a click away. For Studio One, I'm Katie Field.
Biology, music, and political science are among other departments at UND using clickers in selected courses. And that's the news for now. Monty and Kelly?
Thanks a lot, Ken.
Well, it's that time again to get the weather update, so let's go to Stephen Doyle for the weather news. Stephen?
Well, thanks again, Monty and Kelly. Right now, we're going to turn your attention down to the southern part of the country, off the coast of Florida and into the Caribbean, where things have been getting kind of active. What we've been seeing is Tropical Storm Noel causing a few problems. Right now, as of November 1st, 95 miles of southern Florida is under tropical storm warning, including Miami, Fort Lauderdale, and West Palm Beach. From the storm, top winds of 60 miles per hour can be felt, and those winds can extend out to up to 130 miles from the center of the storm. Rip currents and waves up to 10 feet tall are possible, and as of November 1st, it's been moving erratically to the north at about 6 miles per hour. Now, here's where it is as of October 31st. Here's where the footage that you just saw was taken from southern Florida up the coast partway, and as I said, it's expected to move continuing to the north very slowly, and then it's expected to turn off to the northeast. Well, back in the lower 48, one college group is trying to instill an interest in science in young girls. They did this by taking a group of 26 Girl Scouts and attempted to teach them the fascinating aspects of weather.
The student chapter of the American Meteorological Society put together a workshop for girls to learn more about the weather. Activities chair Kelsey Watkins coordinated the event.
I think for girls to see other older girls involved in meteorology, it makes them see that, oh, you know, I can do that. I can go into weather if I want.
The girls rotated between five different stations, learning everything from weather safety.
You wear an undershirt, you wear another undershirt, you wear two.
You wear a lot of layers.
To cloud types.
White and poofy like cotton candy.
My favorite part was just messing around and playing with the dye and seeing how the colder... The cold is heavier and hot is lighter.
Girl Scouts are exposed to much more than just weather, according to program learning specialist Laura Dvorak-Berry.
All around, the girls learn different avenues that maybe they didn't even know would interest them.
The AMS members hope that they may have sparked the interest of meteorology in these young girls. With photographer Dan Kohler, this is Kelly Krumlich for Studio One Weather.
This was the first joint venture between AMS and the Girl Scouts, and they do hope to make it an annual event. Now, earlier we asked you to pick the other weather record that was broken by the Halloween blizzard, and the answer is C, the earliest sub-zero temperature that was felt in the Twin Cities on November 3rd, 1991, at negative 3 degrees Fahrenheit. Monty and Kelly, that shatters the old record set on November 11th of 1986.
Whoa, that is cold. Thanks, Stephen.
All right, let's go to sports news again, and Nick Johnson has that.
Thank you, Monty and Kelly. Athletes of all ages try to be the biggest, strongest, and quickest in their sports, but for some, lifting weights and eating right isn't enough.
Some athletes choose to boost their performance by using illegal performance-enhancing drugs. Even some high school athletes have been caught using them.
It's a problem from middle schoolers on up to elite athletes in the Olympics.
Many people choose to work out naturally by lifting weights to enhance their bodies. For some, that's not enough. They choose alternative ways to try to get a cut above the rest. An athlete taking steroids may not be aware of the negative effects it may have on their body.
Acne, roid rage, anxiety, paranoia, widening of the teeth.
Currently, high school athletes in Minnesota and North Dakota aren't tested for drugs.
At this point, it hasn't been mandated by the legislature in the state of North Dakota.
But with college athletes, it's a whole different ballgame.
Right now at the University of North Dakota, we have two types of testing from the NCAA itself. There is the random drug testing, which they can show up at any given time, and the other one is post-championship testing.
If an athlete tests positive for drugs, the consequences can be severe.
You are banned from that sport or from any NCAA sport for 365 days. If you are caught a second time, you're done completely in any sport sponsored by the NCAA.
Doctors say as the days go by, the topic gains even more popularity.
People have always been using these agents, but I think we're seeing more of it. I think the testing will become more common over the next 20 years.
Dr. Haug says it seems like the cheaters are always two steps ahead of the people that are trying to stop them. With photographer Yarian Johansson, I'm Kevin Green reporting for Studio One Sports.
Last year, New Jersey was the first state in the nation to randomly test high school athletes for steroids. Texas and Oregon are considering adopting a similar strategy. Now the answer to this week's Studio One Sports trivia question, who was the only team in college basketball history to beat three number one seeds in an NCAA tournament? Well, you might remember the 1997 Arizona Wildcats, led by Mike Bibby and Miles Simon. They were able to do it on their way to a national championship. And that's the sports. Monty and Kelly.
Thanks, Nick. Kids sometimes feel the need to tell on other children if they are misbehaving. More and more incidents are rising where adults are calling the police on the people next door. We'll tell you what people say about neighbors tattling on neighbors.
Also, NASA has major launches that often break records. Recently, a man-made rocket broke a North Dakota launch record. We'll take you to the event that made a group fly into the record books.
Studio One closed captioning is underwritten in part by University of North Dakota student government.
What are you doing?
Earning my engineering degree online through UND.
Engineering online? You can't do that.
Well, I am.
Huh. Well, I bet UND doesn't offer nursing online.
It does.
What about social work?
That too.
The University of North Dakota offers unique online courses and degree programs. From bachelor to master's level, you can find more than 15 degrees online.
How about forensic psychology?
That too.
We know exactly what you're looking for.
Because we've already found it.
The Energy and Environmental Research Center in Grand Forks, North Dakota has opportunities available for you. You'll work with a dynamic team of professionals in a variety of programs that have gained international recognition. We offer competitive salaries, an outstanding benefits package, and a place for you to pursue your dreams. To learn more about opportunities at the EERC, visit us on the web.
The Workforce Development Office helped our organization identify specific health concerns faced by our employees. Along with that, they also helped us come up with a wellness program to address those concerns. They did a great job for us as we finalized our plans for the Alaris Wellness at Work program.
Call us to help your organization discover creative solutions to your workforce challenges. Workforce Development, a service of the Division of Continuing Education at the University of North Dakota.
You're watching Studio One, twice named the best college television show in the nation by the National Association of College Broadcasters.
A couple of weeks ago, we visited with a rocketeer on our show about the next rocket his group was launching. We tagged along to see what all the excitement was about.
364 days a year, this field is just a field. But today, it's a launch pad.
There's a lot of anxiety, but a lot of excitement, you know, at the same time.
Tim Young and other rocketeers like him have been preparing for this launch for a year. However, not everything today is rocket science.
Oh, we forgot our cradles to hold the rocket up while we're working on it. And then a few bolts.
Despite a few glitches, they keep their eyes on the skies. The rocket attracted many enthusiasts to the launch site. Tim even had a special visitor who drove across two states to get here.
I'm Tim's mother. Very happy to say that I am Tim's mother.
The passion of rocket launches runs in their family.
The last launch where they put the robots on Mars, we had a Mars party and we had everything red to eat.
Tim began reaching for the sky when he was 8 years old. Since then, he's had some launches go a little off course.
I mean, it looked like it was a perfect flight, and then it suddenly took a right angle turn.
He and his brother grandfather set off this rocket in Madison that ended up going through someone's bedroom window.
And then we kind of got scared. And then we went up and asked for our rocket back.
Luckily, this rocket is far away from any windows.
Three, two, one.
As a year's work blasts into the sky, it could be one small step for science.
The future of, you know, of humans is to get off this planet.
Or one giant leap for these rocketeers.
That was fantastic. I mean, the launch was incredible.
For Tim, the thrill of their hard work taking off is literally out of this world. I'm Stephanie Flieger reporting for Studio One.
The rocket reached a height of about a mile and a half. Tim and the students plan to launch the rocket again in April. Everyone has heard stories of good and bad neighbors. The definition of good and bad may be getting clearer. There's a new law in California that threatens a $100 penalty for parents who are caught smoking in the presence of their underage child. These types of laws are often enforced by the person next door who calls into authorities. We wanted your thoughts on whether or not you would tattle on your neighbor.
If it's harming someone or they're endangering somebody's safety, yes, then I would tell on them. But otherwise, if it's just something small like watering their grass when they're not supposed to, no, then I probably wouldn't.
No. Because not everybody's perfect, and I sometimes have done small things too, so.
Yeah, I think I would if there was, you know, if it was all the time.
Generally not, but I mean, if my kid's safety was at risk, then yeah, I would. But if it's not hurting anybody, no.
It depends on what crime it would be, I guess.
Not for a small crime. I would say it'd have to be pretty major to tell on them.
Speeding, yes. Burning leaves, no, unless it was going to do harm to my house.
Our next guest has a disorder that few people can easily detect. We will talk to a man who was diagnosed with a problem that is usually associated with children.
With UND's correspondence and online studies, you can take college courses where, when, and how you want. Enroll at any time with self-paced courses available online or by mail.
And I set up the whole thing myself. When I do the lessons, when I take the test, it's all set up by me.
Fit courses around your schedule, even if you work full-time.
You can do it on your own time, work around your schedule.
Credits transfer to most colleges. Contact UND today.
Wall Street has come to the prairie through the A. Kirk Lannerman Investment Center at the University of North Dakota. This state-of-the-art facility in the College of Business and Public Administration provides hands-on experience in the world of modern finance. Students learn how financial markets react with lightning quickness to world events. They use cutting-edge technology and real-time data from more than 200 financial markets around the world. The Lannerman Investment Center provides the tools to make a career out of an education.
There's a place where American Indian culture is celebrated, where helping others is a priority and encouragement is abundant. At American Indian Student Services, our goal is retention and graduation of American Indian students. The American Indian Center is a home away from home, where students can find state-of-the-art technology and a friendly face willing to help. Contact American Indian Student Services at 1-800-CALL-UND.
The University of North Dakota Graduate School offers unique opportunities for students who love to keep their eyes on the skies.
Atmospheric science students are using advanced radar to see what's happening deep inside the clouds. Students and professors in our space studies program are helping to shape the future of interplanetary travel. Major projects include designing and testing a spacesuit for the mission to Mars. Reach for the skies and beyond with a graduate degree from the University of North Dakota.
Hard to keep focus and finish a task in a world full of distractions. If you have attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, it can even be more challenging. Assistant Professor Michael Gallo has ADHD and he's here to tell us what he does to accomplish his goals. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
You're welcome.
Okay, what are the signs that someone might have that could hint towards maybe they having ADHD?
Well, some of the symptoms and signs are inattentiveness, inability to focus on something for long periods of time, the inability to complete tasks. And of course, one of the myths about ADHD is it's a person that can't attend to anything. And what we really know is that someone with ADHD wants to pay attention to everything around them. And part of that problem is that distractiveness. Oh, I hear something over there. I better go look over there. I see something going on. I better go pay attention to that. And the challenge is to try and get that person to focus in on one thing at a time long enough so they can complete a task, finish an assignment. And that's another symptom, is that a person who's consistently later in inability to finish schoolwork.
Now, I know the H in ADHD is hyperactivity. Is that the only kind of way to see if they have ADHD, or is there different kind of things that one may do?
No, ADHD, the most recent diagnosis is that there's ADHD with hyperactivity and then ADHD inattentive, which means people who could be staring out the window looking perfectly fine and not realizing they're 100 miles away. The hyperactivity is what we tend to land up diagnosing more. It's more noticeable, it's more disruptive in the classroom, which is why boys tend to be diagnosed at a far greater rate than females do, because females are more inattentive. They're the ones who are in class, look like they're just doing fine, they're quiet, they're not a problem, and then you realize they're failing in their schoolwork, they're getting behind, and with the diagnosis, we can help them gain some skills to be more successful.
Now, when were you diagnosed with ADHD?
I wasn't diagnosed until I was about 35. I was working on my master's degree, trying to get through that after teaching preschool, and I discovered I just can't get through these papers. I can't seem to finish the readings. You know, what's going on here? I was doing so fine as a preschool teacher. I could run around and chase after children. And I actually talked to a parent who said, you know, I have some of the same characteristics, and I went and got diagnosed, and it's really helped me out. So after that, it made a huge difference, but it did take me until I was 35.
What were you exactly like as a child, since it took you till 38 to be diagnosed?
I was a teacher's nightmare. I was the kind of kid who spent a lot of time in the principal's office kind of hanging out. I was a person sent out in the hallway. I was always up sharpening my pencil, trying to get out of my seat. I was the talkative person. I was the jokester, because if I could get people to laugh with me, they wouldn't laugh at me. I was the kind of person that I think some teachers wish they could have retired before they got me in the classroom.
Now, is medication the only way to treat ADHD?
Oh, absolutely not. There's many ways in which we can help a person with ADHD, and the most recent research suggests that it's a combination of using Ritalin or other kind of medications combined with cognitive therapy, becoming aware of your disability, as well as discovering strategies and skills. Some children don't need it at all. Other people, the medication really works for them. And so we have to realize that it's an individualized way of treating that disability.
Now, what are some strategies that someone might use?
Well, for me, one of my issues is time. They've discovered that the brains of people with ADHD don't measure time very well, and that's time related to the day, how much time we have left in this interview, how much time for me to finish this project. So my computer, for instance, talks to me every 15 minutes so that it just a little note of it's 3:15. So that keeps me on task. I use an egg timer when I'm grading papers. When I go into the store, if I don't keep my track on time, I might stand in front of the peanut butter shelf for 20 minutes figuring out crunchy peanut, you know, which one do I get? So I do those strategies to help me. I like to have something to drink to keep my, for some stim for me, squeeze a stress ball, get up and move every 15, 20 minutes so I don't find myself just drifting off. And I especially have to monitor my computer time because it's so easy once you're on the internet, you find this site and pretty soon, again, I can't measure time. Gee, I've spent an hour and a half on the internet. I learned all about the twins, but I didn't get my assignments done. So becoming aware of what I need to do has become really critical for me.
Now you're doing presentations. What exactly does your presentations focus on?
I try to give them mostly my perspective on having ADHD. So when we start off my presentation right away, I've got music blaring in the background, I've got a TV and a story going, I've got people hitting tambourines, and so they can understand all of this distraction that goes on. And then I start giving them information, and I begin to see the eyes getting wide, and I see the stress level starting rising. And then I talk about that's a little bit of what it's like for me every day, trying to manage all the stim that's coming into me, the music playing in my head, and the tasks I'm trying to complete. And then I talk about how we help people with ADHD manage that stress. What can they do about that? Because stress gives us three basic responses. We're going to flight, we're going to hit, and we're going to freeze. And that's what we often hear about children in schools. They're fighting, they're hitting, they're aggressive. Well, of course, they're trying to deal with that stress. Or they're hiding, they're under the table, they're leaving out the door. They're trying to get away from those things that they can't manage themselves. So I think that's a really critical thing to think about. And I give some strategies. I talk about that with the participants. And then I always try to get them to look at the difference between behavior that is normal and abnormal, because we have to make that distinguishing characteristic.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. It's such an interesting topic.
Well, thank you. I appreciate being here.
You're watching Studio One from the University of North Dakota. We'll be right back after this.
Studio One closed captioning is underwritten in part by University of North Dakota student government.
Hey, what are you waiting for? Your future is here. You can earn your degree online.
The University of North Dakota offers more than 15 online degree programs. Earn your degree from home. Your future is online. Contact UND Continuing Education to get started on your online degree today.
Now it's an extremely exciting time in UND history, and it's a thrill to be a part of that.
Get in now. Get in on the ground floor.
The time is now. Get involved. Everyone can make a difference.
Well, the fans and former players, there's still that sense of ownership. They're still a part of the program, and this is a time for them to step up.
What better place to give than to your alma mater?
This can happen.
Excuse me, can I get a ride?
What?
My car broke down. Can I get a ride?
No, I can't help you.
Look, it's just a ride.
No, step back.
Get in the car!
No!
Women can defend themselves. To learn more about Impact U or to enroll in a class, call the UND Women's Center.
I think Studio One is the best thing that UND has to offer for any student that wants to go into broadcasting.
Really professional, a lot of fun, team-oriented, and friendly.
All right, excellent, guys. Thanks for coming.
You really do get close to the people here. I mean, they're almost like family.
What I've learned here will take me so far.
To learn more about Studio One, visit our website at www.studioone.und.edu.
Tune in next week on Studio One. Instruments take time and dedication to learn. This can be especially true for unconventional instruments. Next week, we will have a band that plays music with items found in your tool shed. Plus, we'll have other news and entertainment stories for you.
We're going to leave you now with pictures of pumpkins, courtesy of photographer Wilu Su. From all of us here at Studio One, have a great week.